Okay, so here we're interviewing Rick Springfield. I have quite a history with Rick, known him a long time.
Nothing sexual.
No, we kept it clean, my first question, Rick, does your wife Barbara still cook for you every night, and did you bring any leftovers with you?
She does cook for me every night, and Maddie was over at my studio last night and had bolognese, and it was incredible. She's a goddess, and the reason I have the home studio is because of her cooking, because I was going to, like, get a place somewhere else, because I was, you always, we're used to going somewhere else to record, so when you come home, you can kind of just let it go. But she said, well, if you build a studio here, I'll cook for you. So I went, yeah, okay, that worked.
Yeah, my family used to go over to his house in the late 80s a lot, and we were always cooked for, so I do miss those days. And
she's now, an amazing cook.
You know, Rick and his band get to enjoy those times.
And this is like how I kind of imagined we'd be, like, you know, in the new millennium, Timmy and I, just the only thing missing is a rocking chair. You know, really? I mean, we're kind of sitting here reminiscing and cool.
And you didn't bring a dog with you. But.
I know. Bindi is more Barbie's dog. I'm completely jealous because I'm stone in love with her, but she loves Barbie more than me.
Yeah, Bindi has been here before. Bindi's the new one. I did get bit by Ron.
Oh. Lawsuit.
Rick's dog. No, it's the same as the Neil Giraldo story. We were at Sound City.
Except he actually nipped you.
He did.
Yeah.
We were at Sound City in the large room. I was at one end. Ron was at the other end.
This is Ronnie from my working class dog cover.
So this would be like 1983 or something, maybe.
Yeah.
Maybe something like that. And the dog looked at me for about a minute with this sense of purpose. And then he strode. He didn't really run
he
over.
Said, I like white meat.
He strode right over to where I was sitting and bit me lightly in the crotch.
It was a love thing.
And, you know.
He's a guitar fan.
I think that happened to other people, too. I wasn't the only one that happened to.
Well, I think you're the only one that actually got teeth to skin.
Yeah.
Some were threatened, like Giraldo was threatened with the...
Okay, I forgot. Okay, yeah, I got nipped.
Yeah, you actually got nipped.
Lately. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so...
Do you have the scar?
No, but I have a photo that I dug up. Maybe we can put it, you know, scan it or something, of me laying on the floor at your house and Ron with his head on my crotch, so...
You were the only one that would let Ronnie completely lick your face. We'd lie, we'd sit in the jacuzzi and talk, and Timmy and I get very deep when we get in the jacuzzi. I don't know what it is, but we start talking about deep stuff, and Ronnie would stand on the side, just do this all day, all night long, Timmy's face.
That's before I found out that dogs lick a lot of things.
Yes, yes.
But he was a very clean, he had good breath. You kept him clean, right?
Yes, his butthole sparkled.
Yeah, it did. It was no danger there. It was worth it to me. Okay, my next question is, you've always bought amazing cars for everyone in your family, but you've never really had an amazing car. But maybe your car was amazing and I just didn't know it. Until you got your new Corvette.
Right.
Are you loving your new Corvette?
Yeah, the Vette's amazing. I actually, for a brief period, I had a 63 Corvette in the
80s. I remember that, the real one, yeah.
Yeah, but it was, all original and really hard to drive. It was... I'd get out of the car after driving in L.A. traffic and just limp away, and it was all hot. So I loved the look of the car, but finally settled on a Lexus. And I'm sorry, but there is nothing cool about a Lexus, but they are awesome cars. They never, ever stop. And I had a 250,000-mile Lexus that never left me, and it was beautiful, and I loved that great stereo. I pimped it out.
So you would still have that car if it hadn't gotten wrecked?
Yep.
Huh?
And some guy was texting and ran into me, and did $8,000 worth of damage. Unfortunately, the car was only worth, by that time, three.
The funny thing, you would show up to Rick's house, and there'd be all these gleaming luxury cars that he had bought for his wife and his kids, and probably lots of other people, too. And Rick would have the old Lexus from, like, I don't know when.
I'm loyal to my cars. My dad was loyal to our cars, too. We used to name our cars, and we'd keep them until they died, you know? Okay. And my mom drove... The car we bought in England when I was a kid in England was our first really good car, our only really good car, was a Ford Zephyr. And we bought it in England and had it shipped back to Australia. And my mom sold that to some young guy, you know, who loved old cars, like, I don't know, only 10 years ago.
Amazing.
So we get very loyal to our cars. And I'm very loyal to things that that perform great, you know, and it was awesome. And my Corvette, my new Corvette, which I love, it's a 63 Corvette, but it's new engine, new drivetrain, and all that. And it's kind of, it's a bit of a trailer queen. And at my goddaughter's wedding, I'm driving, trying to get to my goddaughter's wedding, and the thing blows up, and like there's smoke coming out the back.
I have ridden in that car once, and my only problem with that car is that I think it gets you in trouble with the law. That's okay, it's worth it.
It does get me in trouble with the law.
It's just, it shakes the earth, and it's...
But I've since had mufflers put on it. I learned there's... Not all attention is good. So I had this loud car. It was so loud. And the cop pulled me over because it was so loud. And I actually had a glass of wine, and so I got a DUI.
Oh, you don't have to go into it. You don't have to, but...
That's all right. I'm not ashamed of it because I don't drink and drive anymore. So.
I was in the car, and the amount of people... and women that waved at us was astounding when we were in that car. So it's worth it.
Unfortunately, it's mostly guys going, yeah.
I didn't experience that.
Yeah. Do you have questions on your iPhone?
Too? I do.
This is a man prepared.
So I remember Sound City, which we'll talk just a little bit about. And I want to thank you for inviting me to the movie and insisting that they put a picture or two of me in the movie.
I said, I'm not in this unless Tim shows at least twice. And they said, okay. Yeah. It was in the contract.
I realized that when
but
I
you
saw
were there,
it.
You were a huge part of all that.
You know, I was thinking about it, and Sound City was a big part of my life, but really a bigger part was Goodnight LA, which was next door. But
that became, that grew from Sound City. Keith wouldn't have had Goodnight LA if it hadn't been for Sound City. Yeah. And Sound City wouldn't have been Sound City without Keith. I mean, he was...
Yeah, Keith is a very dear friend of ours, and Keith is a very intimidating guy, but he still hires me all the time, which is really wonderful. But he was a huge producer in the 80s. Mm-hmm. You would walk in through past his Lamborghini and his Ferrari, and which he had in the garage next door, and into the studio that had Pirelli rubber floors, and these, you know...
It was the antithesis of Sound City.
Yeah.
Sound City looked like a double-wide trailer, and Keith's studio right next door looked like something from, you know, Logan's Run back in the 70s. It was like futuristic and pristine, and you could eat off the floor, whereas if you ate off the floor in Sound City, you'd probably get some serious disease.
Yes, Keith's studio, he was so proud of the fact, you know, he said to me, you know, this lounge was designed like an airport lounge so that you can't be comfortable for more than 20 minutes. He was so proud.
That's a great idea.
That's a good idea. Smart.
And Sound City did a similar thing, only theirs was, if you stayed more than 20 minutes, you'd get some kind of skin virus.
The thing that astounded me was I got to join Rick's band at a moment when he was arguably the biggest star in the country, and that was for two reasons, because he had a number one hit and because he had a number one TV show at this particular time. And he had these lovely people who managed him, and their office was under a driveway.
Yeah.
And even
the ramp up to the parking lot up top, their roof was perpetually like this. So you'd walk in and kind of bang your head and have to kind of walk into the tall part of the building of the room.
You literally couldn't use half of the office because the thing dropped down,
right.
And you had to duck your head.
Golden Platinum Records, you go, oh, there's one over there. And you go, oh, okay. Oh, back in that little corner.
But I know those guys were like family to you, Joe and Tom, and it was pretty awesome. You know, it's probably like owning the same car for a long time.
Yeah,
you know,
Joe was a very comfortable guy, and I think I looking back now, after having seen the documentary, which the Sound City documentary, which really kind of encapsulates that studio, I think really, really well. I think I don't know whether they intended it or not, but to me, Joe's. The photos of Joe and everything in it. Joe Gottfried owned Sound City. He, his vibe was what made that studio. What brought, the, you know, he had some.
He had was
something.
A sweet
it was
guy.
Just a hole, you
he
know.
He was a sweet guy. I mean, I've dealt with a lot of music managers, and they can be very effective and very successful and very
jerky.
Well, they're very rarely sweet.
Yeah, they're not. A lot of them aren't nice people, Joe was a beautiful guy.
Yeah.
More power to him for now having probably, I would say, maybe the second most famous studio in the world.
Yeah, it was a beautiful thing that that documentary got made.
Yeah.
Couple more things. There was a point when we were touring. We'll talk about gear in a second, but there was a point where we were touring where you used to jump on my back during Jesse's Girl. Do you remember that?
Oh yes.
And you did it every night. You did it once, and then you did it every night. And I am still...
Still have back problems?
No, I'm fine. But how is it that... How is it that I was able to carry you on my back?
And play the solo. Unbelievable.
You forgot, huh?
No, I know it. I remember jumping on your back. I thought, oh, this is fun.
I used to think, how is this possible? You're a big guy.
Sorry, Timmy, I'm lucky you don't have back problems.
No, it's good. It's good. It's just funny. I was thinking of some of the funny things that happened. Another funny thing I remember happening was when we played at the Budokan, which was, I think, 3 or 5 nights in a row in Japan. And I don't know if you remember this, but the smoke machines that they used on the first night completely covered us.
Enveloped the stage.
You could not see anything.
Till about the 5th or 6th song.
Yeah, right? We were just invisible in smoke.
We were laughing. Like, you couldn't see anything. Yeah. The audience couldn't see us. Yeah. We couldn't see each other.
Yeah.
That was pretty funny.
It was pretty funny. There were other things, too. I remember Goodnight LA and Sound City were right next door, but I remember there was more partying done while recording at Goodnight LA.
There was.
That's
well, mainly because the floors were cleaner, and you could get naked girls to lay down on the floor without them getting any serious diseases.
And we don't party anymore, but it was a pretty wild time.
It was a wild scene. And it, you know, we didn't... I never did any drugs, really. I mean, I kind of drank a little bit, but it was probably very drug-fueled. I just wasn't aware of it. Yeah. I was kind of fairly innocent.
You were, I remember. All you did was work 14 hours a day. I do remember that.
Mm-hmm. That's all I do now.
It's true. I believe Rick is making the best music he's ever made and the best records he's ever made. And part of the reason for that is the way they're produced and recorded. By your team, and which is Maddie, and Greg Bissonette. Not Greg Bissonette.
Matt
Bissonette. And did you actually do the last two records with Matt?
Yeah, Venus and Overdrive and Songs for the End of the World, I wrote with Matt and produced with Matt. And he's great because he's got elements that I don't have. He's incredibly musical, and I can get ideas, but not necessarily be able to execute them all, whereas he can play anything, you know.
He fills in all the blanks and keeps you going, keeps you moving.
Yeah, he's got the whip going. Yeah. I mean, Shocked and I'll Anger Acceptance, which is to me is one of my favorite records, just because it was very written with a lot of anger and pain, and it really shows that to me on the record. But it took us 11 months to do it, and
well,
Venus took
busy,
one
right?
month,
and okay.
Shock and Songs for the End of the World took like 28 days, less than that.
Okay, so
we
they're
really
getting faster.
The and
that's getting faster.
That map,
yeah,
which is you need sometimes.
Well, I hope you guys continue because I do believe you're making the best music.
Yeah,
you've ever
we played. Are. Even though he's been abducted by Elton John, he's
heard about
we're
that.
We're still emailing, and we're going to get together and write the next record for sure.
Good. Oh, that's great. That's great news. There was a fan who wrote in asking a question about that, and she will be pleased. I think it was a she.
Maybe get rid of those.
Yes, I love that.
Sure that.
So great.
Good point.
It's a great sound, a little thing.
Are those double mics?
Let's just talk about guitars for a second. Do you remember those Marshalls that we had made? Because
we
loved Neil Giraldo's guitar sound on the Pat Benatar records.
Right. Well, Neil played on Jesse's
That's
Girl.
That's right, he played on Jesse's Girl.
And I saw his amps, and I loved the sound. I always loved Marshalls, but they were a really unique Marshall. It was a 50-watt, what are they called?
Combo.
All-in-one. Combo.
Yeah, with
212. With a head and the speakers in the one box. And And it was a great sound, and we couldn't find any, so we had them made.
Yeah, they were beautiful. Yeah. I remember when we got them done, we took the amps out of the heads and put them in custom combo amps.
As you can see from Timmy's guitars, we're absolute, you know, guitar whores.
Yeah, they'll keep coming.
Yeah, they were amazing.
And the speakers were really unusual. They were very clean EVM 12Ls, which you would not think of using now, but for whatever reason, during that period, they provided great sounds. And Living in Oz was probably my you know, it was one of the best records I've ever done in my life, guitar-wise. And that was
awesome.
Those were Marshalls with, mm-hmm. with the EVMs, probably just an SM57 into mm-hmm. a Neve mic pre. I think that's all we did.
Yeah.
And whatever guitars we would choose.
Bill was great. His strongest suit was his guitar sound.
Yeah, Bill Drescher. Yeah.
He could make a crappy guitar sound, just
yeah.
dial it up and it would sound like God.
Yeah, he was one of those breed of engineers, and I run into him still where whatever you give them, they make it sound 5 times better
yeah,
immediately.
Yeah.
And he was one of those guys.
And that was done, most of that was done in Studio A at Sound City.
Was that the blue carpeted room on the side or the big
No, that was oh, B. B. The B yeah, was the was small the, one.
Yeah, okay.
We did some in there, but we did a lot of it in Studio A. But I know we did a lot of the solos in Studio B.
That's right.
Yeah. I can remember. Yeah. I still have a visual of you playing and how you'd work out the solo bit by bit.
We did Love Somebody in that side.
We did an A.
Oh, we did an A.
We did the track in A. I mean, we may have done. We also did part of that up in San Francisco.
But that was not with me. That was with.
It was just vocals.
Yeah.
But Studio A, I think we used a lot of ambience, of this amazing Studio A ambience, because it was, for some reason, it was incredible there.
Yeah,
ambience was amazing. It was just some big square room that happened to sound incredible. It shouldn't have. As Dave Grohl says in the Sound City thing, it was a box that shouldn't have sounded like it did. And it was a factory, a converted Vox factory. It's incredible.
Yeah, and I thought, as everybody did, that all that stuff would be around forever.
Mm-hmm.
We thought, because it was such a huge thing happening all over town, we thought it would be there forever, but
yeah.
change happened.
Yeah, I didn't actually know that it closed down until Dave said that it had, and that he bought the board. I actually wasn't aware of that.
I think somebody has it privately right now. So
what, the studio?
Sound City, yeah.
Oh, it's just still a studio?
Yeah. But it's private.
Well, I hope they haven't removed the parquet from the walls. That'd be a shame. And that cheap tile in the bathroom with God knows what mixed in with the grout.
Yeah, it's amazing, a place that was never upgraded or remodeled
never.
In decades. You walk in
Even
there,
when it was making a shitload of money, it was never upgraded.
Amazing.
And Joe, God bless him, he'd take the sparkless water bottles and you fill them up from the faucet in the bathroom and then tip them back up down, upside down on the thing. And everyone would think, oh, sparkling water. It tastes kind of lead.
A heart and soul of practicality.
Oh, my God, he was awesome.
Yeah, great. Well, these days you use Bogners on
yeah,
stage?
Yeah, on stage I use Bogners.
Reinhold is a wonderful guy. I know him. You've met Reinhold, or have you not?
I don't think I met him, no. Oh, I might have met him at NAMM.
Yeah,
I met him at NAMM.
Great amps.
Yeah. Yeah, they're great. I love them. And Matty Barato, a luthier, makes guitars for me that I really love. They're super light. And I love a light guitar on stage.
Yeah.
So I can throw it around. But now with the pickups the way they are, you can basically stick them on a plank, you know, and they'll sound great. And Matty makes these ones with my logo on it. And they're really cool. They're great to play. And I use those through the Bogner. Sounds great. I mean, I never use pedal. I just stick it straight in, and well, probably not a good choice of phrase, but I plug right in, and it sounds comes up, and Matty says, "Sounds great."
Yeah, it probably does sound great. I don't think I've heard you with the Bogner.
Oh, I think he's lying to me.
I heard you with the Nailers.
Yeah, sounds great.
And you're still touring all the time.
Yeah.
All the time. Mm-hmm.
I just actually changed managers and agents. And so we're going to be, and we just got a whole new production with video screens and everything on live. So we're definitely going to be doing a lot more stuff. We just got back from Europe, actually, where we played these, like, I mean, all the audiences were guys. I mean, it was like the first time we did the Sweden Rock Festival, I said, shit, there's like 20,000 guys out there. What are we going to do? But they were totally into it. They knew Living in Oz. They knew all the, because they're guitar guys.
That's amazing.
And my record, because of you and the fact that I play guitar and write on guitar, our guys' records, they're from a guy's perspective with guitars about women. So, you know, they get that. They don't have the whole, like, General Hospital thing to go, oh, he's a soap opera actor, you know. So we just got back from there, and once with the Swedish Rock Festival we did, the Kiss closed, and friggin' Five Finger Death Punch were on with us, and we're playing, and all the audience is going crazy, and it was great. It was just
You were always a legit rocker, and the people who knew you knew that, and I think Dave Grohl always knew that. Mm-hmm. You play loud. You're like in the Who when you get up there,
I love guitars, I think that, and I love to play live, and I think that translates. You know, people get that vibe. I love to see someone having a great time on stage.
I want to see
someone playing, staring at their feet. You know?
Yeah, you had to wait a couple of decades to get some guys to show up.
Yeah, I know.
I'm happy for you.
We went to Japan though, and it was all guys, and we said, where were you guys in the 80s? And they said, well, we couldn't go because it was a girls act, but we still loved the music. So that's part of the joys, I think, of living a little bit longer than, you know, maybe they thought you would.
Well, you did a smart thing in that you never stopped touring and you never let go of your audience. Mm-hmm. And
writing's always been really important to me, too. Putting out what I think is the best stuff that I can put out. And not just going, we need a record this year. Because honestly, you got to do it now just for the love of it with the record industry the way it is.
No, it's true. It's even what we're doing today is I'm doing this for the love of it. This is my solo record, mm-hmm. basically. You know, you do your solo records and you do it because you love it. It's mm-hmm. great. I guess my last question is, we don't really get together in the jacuzzi anymore. So, and I asked you this once before. Is it okay if I come over and use your jacuzzi once in a while?
As long as Bindi can lick your face.
Okay.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely.
We have some questions from the interweb. Let me find a good one here. Oh, this is good. Kathleen Smith Spencer says, what advice would the state your age?
What?
Something year old Rick Springfield tell the 18-year-old.
63.
Okay. Didn't want to cross a boundary. You're proud of it. What would the 63-year-old Rick Springfield tell the 18-year-old Rick Springfield?
Wow. So much. I don't think we have long enough.
I was going to kind of answer for you and say that you should have just joined the Eagles at one point.
Was I?
What?
No.
Okay. Find the next
one. Oh, God, I'd say, you know, just be smarter. Hang on to your money. Watch people. Don't believe everybody. But still have the passion that you know, I'm surprised sometimes when I look back at the young guy and the dreams and the things that I wanted to do, there's a lot I still want to do, but to have done what I've done is, I'd be surprised as a kid, I think. I'd be sitting here in America because I think America was like the greatest thing in the world. So the only place I wanted to be.
Well, the other thing is that you've done it your whole life, which not a lot of people get to do. Mm-hmm. And that kind of impresses me. Okay, we'll find another one. Oh, I know that I like this one. Kate Dennis. I know that Rick has a large guitar collection. If he could have any guitar for that collection from a musically historical perspective of maker ownership, which would that be?
Wow. I'd be either Hank Marvin's first Strat that it was ever imported into Europe, which is a 1960 Fiesta Red Strat that actually Cliff Richard owned and then gave to Bruce Welch, and Hank is still mad that Bruce ended up with it. This is a band, Shadows, big in England. Or I'd have Paul McCartney's bass with the Shea Stadium set list still stuck to it. Or I'd have John Lennon's Rickenbacker with the Shea Stadium set list still. Either one of those would work for me.
Rick does own some pretty amazing Beatles original handwritten lyrics. And was I supposed to say that?
No, yeah, that's cool.
Okay, but you can't find them. They're
yeah, they're away. Yeah, there's no Paul McCartney ones involved in it at all.
Looking. Well, here's one. Of all your guitars on the road, which are your favorite and why?
I have a Tobacco Telly that I really love that just feels good. I don't know why. I play better on that, I think, than any of the others. And I do love actually the ones Matty Barato makes that I was talking about before.
Yeah, right. Okay.
They're kind of a bigger Les Paul look, but thin and really super lightweight. And they're great. Really, really cool to play.
Here's the last question. It's one that we really liked from Mike Groves. Rick, you are a great musician, singer, as well as an accomplished actor.
Did you say that one more time?
Rick, you are a great musician / singer.
I'm sorry, I missed it one more time.
As well as an accomplished actor and saintly dude. Are there things that both of these things share in common as far as how you prepare for performing in either of those artistic endeavors?
Yes, there are. They feed a similar kind of need in me, I think. And there's something similar to finishing a scene as an actor and feeling like you kind of nailed it and pulled something out of yourself and you know, set it out there, as similar to writing a song and finishing it and going, yeah, I think I kind of nailed that. And it's a similar kind of feeling, although the songwriting is a little deeper for me because it goes back further. I was back in Australia a couple of months ago and saw some of the songs I wrote when I was about 15 or 16. They're horrible. They're horrible. Some kid had come to me with those songs and said, what do you think, should I keep this up? I would have said, you know what? Have you ever thought of being an electrician? Really, think about it. They were terrible, dude. They were so lame.
Well, that's inspiring. I'm sure that'll help people. Definitely help people. Well, thanks for joining us today.
I'm very happy to meet.
And we'll do it again.
Yep. I'd like to see you play, Timmy.
Okay. We'll let Jess, you going?
That in. See if you went with it.